So my name is Isabel Thompson. I'm a market research analyst at Oxford University Press. When I was putting this session together, I was working with Adrian Stanley from Digital Science, and we talked a lot about the different things that academic engagement could mean. We ran through several different options, and in the end I decided on the interaction of publishers with academics, and by publishers I sort of mean anyone involved on the publishing side. And the reason I chose this definition was because the entire industry is predicated on the meaningful interaction of publishers with the, researchers with the people that disseminate that research. So it's really not hyperbole to say that without academic engagement, there is no scholarly publishing. The topic is also especially interesting to me because I came directly to scholarly publishing from an academic background. And now, as a market research analyst, I sort of sit in the middle ground, trying to join up the needs and behaviors of researchers on the one side with what goes on the publishing side on the other. So I'm going to provide some context and some considerations. And I'm going to speak for sort of about 10 minutes before handing over to other really great speakers. And there'll be time for questions at the end of all the speakers' presentations. Okay, so I'm going to do three things. First of all, I'm going to go through some examples of researchers' perspectives that impact on the issue of academic engagement. Secondly, I'm going to highlight a couple of problems that these responses reflect. And thirdly, I'm going to run through some of the different types of engagement that we all sort of partake in. I'm a market research analyst. I think about publishing a lot. The average researcher does not think about publishing a lot. And obviously, this is not remotely surprising because we all know that it's just a means to an end for them, you know, to share ideas, to just even reading, let alone get tenure. But they don't care how it works. They really don't care how it works. They just want it to work. However, whether they think about it or not, it is really important. And it's important because publishing and researching have a symbiotic relationship. The health of one side really does depend on the health of the other. So, to try and work out what the health of this relationship might be, I went out all enthused to do some engagement. I sort of talked to people on the publishing side and on the researching side, what they thought about publishing and the publishing process, and what they thought was good and what they thought was bad. I talked to a 25-year-old maths PhD researcher in the third year of her PhD at Oxford. And I asked her, and I was feeling quite enthusiastic at this point, she was the first person I spoke to, what do you think is good about publishing? And she said, and then, she said, and then, she was like, just because I'm thinking doesn't mean I think publishers are bad. And then there was another quite lengthy pause when finally inspiration struck and she had it. Books are good. Oh, God. Okay, you know, I need to do a bit of a better job getting my message across to people, I think. Then I spoke to someone on the researching, on the publishing side, again, speaking quite broadly because he now develops, he's an ex-researcher that develops workflow tools and spends a lot of time with researchers. And he said that he sort of jokingly, he jokingly said that he gets the impression that a lot of researchers think about publishers as sitting somewhere on a spectrum that ranges from pure evil at one side to a necessary evil on the other. Which is kind of depressing, I think, really, and also not true. But, so, these views don't tell the whole story, and nor are they representative of the way that every researcher thinks about the problem. But they do reflect two very important problems that we have as an industry. The first is, and we know this, we really do struggle as an industry to explain what it is that we do in a way that sort of gets people on side and engaged, and we don't have a compelling narrative in the way sometimes that some other voices do. And the second problem is that despite the great news that we have more channels of communication than I think we've probably ever had before, we still have limited interaction with the majority of researchers the majority of the time. We don't and can't, because it's not always for lack of trying, we can't always listen well enough to the people whose needs we're trying to serve. So I think if we look at these two solutions, develop a compelling narrative and listen more. Sounds pretty easy. But it's not always quite that straightforward, because academic engagement takes on so many different forms and has so many different aims. So to sort of illustrate this and put it in a bit more context, I'm going to look at some of the different ways that we engage, which should set the scene for the other speakers. So we have, the first thing to consider is that researchers wear a number of different hats, and their engagement varies and their needs vary depending on what it is that they're trying to do. So the most, in very simplified form, the most relevant role types for this discussion is the researcher as reader, the researcher as author, the researcher as peer reviewer, and the researcher as editorial board member. Small number of researchers, but quite important. And forget trying to engage with different researchers. The same researcher may have completely different perspectives or needs or views on an issue, depending on what issue they're sort of grappling with at the time and which role. So, you know, to pick an obvious example, a reader probably loves gold open access because they can read everything. The very same researcher who happens to be in a really niche and underfunded area with absolutely no money for APCs, a bit like one of the areas that I studied, they're probably going to hate gold open access, or at least they're not going to want it forced upon them or anything like that. And so this is a problem that we have in some of our market research that we do, is that you have to find the right voice to speak to the right people. And you don't always have, even with user profiling, you don't always quite have the opportunity to do that. So I'm now going to think about some of the types of engagement that these four role types experience. The reader has predominantly one way, and often electronic interaction with the publisher, and the flow of information is often from the publisher to the reader. So they often interact with content, obviously, whether online or in a library. They have the publisher's website. They get a lot of emails, journal table of contents, marketing emails, the social media. The author, they also get the publisher's website, but for different purposes, you know, author guidelines, book or journal submission forms. They also have more, we're starting to get more personal contact here, so they've got editorial contact, you know, maybe at conferences, personal emails, phone calls, meetings. The peer reviewer, they also have a lot of editorial contact, you know, mainly requests, mainly email. And the editorial board member, in as far as they might have a sort of interaction with a publisher or with a sort of publishing process, is a slightly different proposition, because it's, you know, to an extent a business partnership, so they might be interested in marketing, sales, finance, usage statistics. There'll be a lot of strategy meetings, a bit more, again, in the way of two-way dialogue. So if we look at these four role types, another thing to think about is how they map onto a researcher's career. The most enduring role type is that of the reader, which starts at undergraduate or before, and will continue throughout the researcher's career and probably afterwards. At some point, the undergraduate who likes what they're studying and decides to take it further might become an author. And around that time, or maybe afterwards, they'll become a reviewer. And then the editorial board role is one that most obviously never require, you know, many journals as well anyway, and people by necessity are more senior and older. So if we look at these role types, you can see that a lot of the one-way communication is with the readers. It's with the first-time authors, the maybe the lesser-known authors as well. And as a researcher progresses through their career, the amount of two-way dialogue that they have with a publisher also increases. And we have the most in-depth strategizing two-way dialogue with, by necessity in a way, a smaller number, because you can't have this conversation with everyone, with a smaller number of often more senior researchers. So you're only getting part of the story. And what I'm interested in, so a lot of people do a lot of great work feeding in researchers' perspectives. However, I'm really interested in what we can do more to increase the dialogue where we don't have any. And also with the new forms of communication that are coming through, are there more things that we can do with social media and perhaps artificial intelligence that, again, could increase the dialogue across all the different role types? So it's obviously all about listening, big part of what I do in market research. And that's the point of this session, is to do some listening, to get some voices that you haven't maybe heard before as well, some perspectives that are a little bit new as well as traditional. And we've got three different people here who are going to speak. We've got someone representing kind of a researcher perspective. We've got someone who works a lot with young people who's going to talk about the way that they interact with content is changing. And we've got someone from society publishing. And I'll introduce them all in a bit more detail in a moment. But they're going to give you some of their own opinions now on the issue of academic engagement, how they see it, how it's going at the moment, and how perhaps we can improve. I think it should be a very interesting session. I already know what they're going to say, and it's very good. And I think we should get started. So, again, please hold all your questions till the end, and we'll start with Dr. Philippa Matthews. So, Dr. Philippa Matthews is a Wellcome Trust Research Fellow at the University of Oxford. Just won a big grant, so it's very exciting. And her work focuses on chronic viral infections. She's also an honorary clinical consultant in clinical infection at Oxford University Hospitals. Oh, mustn't touch my speaker. I saw her speak at a data visualization conference in June, and I was particularly struck by some of her really candid views that she put across, and it really made me think. And I think she's going to do the same sort of thing now, so I hope you enjoy it. Thanks very much.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for making it to the first session of the day. The title slide says it all, really: experiences, reflections, gripes, and a wish list. I'll start with the driest slide, I'm afraid. This is evidently really a representation of my own views. That comes with some caveats, and that will become clear along the way. And yes, I'm a medic, so I've somehow infiltrated a publishing conference. It's a fabulous opportunity for me, but I don't have any real background or experience in publishing other than at the coalface. So it's a really nice opportunity to kind of increase that dialogue. Struggling to move my slide, sorry. So I'd like to show you three pictures which represent my life and work academically. So as Isabel said, I'm an academic virologist. I'm interested in chronic viral infections. This is hepatitis B, which is my current favorite virus. This is a disused diamond mine in Kimberley, which is right in the middle of South Africa. And this is where I'm recruiting patients into clinical cohorts for research studies. And this is a six-year-old's drawing of a mosquito, which represents my interest in public engagement with schools and colleges and university students, and also an interest in infographics and design as a way of communicating ideas. So really that illustrates the answer to the question about why we want to publish. I want to share my results and resources from academic work. I want to drive collaboration and find new people to work with, and probably competition is important in academia as well. I want to be able to represent those patients in South Africa and elsewhere in the world that we recruit and study. How important is it for that, the results of that and those data to be made widely available? It's crucial. And it also represents the hard work of my collaborators and the clinic nurses who work so hard to make that research happen. I've talked about promoting education, including within schools. And clearly, I also need to represent myself to funding bodies and be able to demonstrate the body of work that I'm doing. So this is interesting, isn't it? In the old days, journals were viewed as a means of disseminating ideas, but the most important function that they have now is the certification of quality. And I think that statement does say that the role of journals and publishing is changing fast, and we collectively, on both sides of the fence, need to think really hard about how we use this change to our best advantage. So what are the challenges in doing this? I've got a few slides just to think around some of those ideas. This is my life. Your lives probably look similar, and lots of academic medics have similar lives. So many different and sometimes conflicting roles and responsibilities and affiliations. And actually, the simpler and more streamlined we can make the publishing process, the better for all of us. You know more about this than I do, so I'm not going to say very much other than to say, of course, social media makes an enormous impact. And I think most of that is really for the better. And also that there are these new online portals coming actually fast and in a really exciting way where you can disseminate your work. And of course, open access is part of this, and the Wellcome Trust, who now fund me, is a big driver of this kind of process of making sure that work is openly available. And again, I'm a big fan of that in principle. The Wellcome Trust does actually put a contractual obligation on me to make my work open access. If I don't, it doesn't count as part of my academic record. So, you know, the penalties for not making my work open access are significant. Big data is probably an understatement, isn't it? I think you had a specific presentation around this idea yesterday. If I look at my own work, hepatitis B, I might have several thousand patients. I'm sequencing the entire human genome from each of them. And I'm sequencing viruses out of their blood, which may number 100 million copies per mil of blood. Big data. Impact factor is interesting. This is a self-fulfilling graph, which says that impact factor is directly related to the number of citations that an article gets. Well, yes, because that's how it's calculated. So it's a nonsense graph. And I think there's a sort of sense of just starting to question the impact factor and how much we're driven by it and what it means. Corporate hierarchy is massive in academic medicine. I can't speak for other fields, but in my own field, I've been languishing down at the bottom as marked for two decades or so. It's possible I'll start to drift upwards at some point. But if this is the guy at the top, we're in trouble. And you know, I do think there's an impact from that. And because of sitting on this conveyor belt for two decades, I have learnt a paradigm about how publishing works, right? Which is that it's a conveyor belt, and you do A, and then B, and then C. There's not much dialogue. You have a kind of closed online submission portal, as you can see depicted there. And the occasional live interaction that you might have with a human being is generally because your article's been rejected. So, brace yourselves. This is my list of complaints. Look, recently I was looking for somewhere to publish a specific piece of work and I wanted to find the right place to put it. And the first journal I looked at said on their website, please don't contact us. We don't accept pre-submission inquiries. Not very encouraging. I have to provide a wet copy signature from all the authors on my work before I can even submit it for the first time. Well, guys, that might be 35 people in six continents. I mean, that's what academic work now looks like. I could provide you with signatures, you know, when it's accepted, but I think that needs some discussion. A long process of review and rejection of an article that finally got rejected because it's not a randomized controlled trial. Well, the title of the article says that this is an observational cohort study, so that should have been rejected on day one, not after 10 weeks in review. A review article that goes through, again, a lengthy process of review and re-review and then gets sent out to a new set of reviewers whose opinions conflict directly with the first set of reviewers, and then it gets rejected. I find that I'm increasingly burdened by these long lists of requirements that are made of me at the point of the first submission to a journal. I've recently made a beautiful little infographic, which I quite enjoy doing, but I can tell you most people don't, to depict my article as a picture. Now, not appropriate at the point of first submission. That article got rejected, and my lovely infographic is wasted. This is another example of a kind of frustration, a paper that I published, which post-publication, we spotted, or a reader actually spotted, that there's a small error in one of the supplementary data tables with columns transposed. And the journal is absolutely unwilling or unable to offer me any way of correcting that. And I think there should be a transparent process. I don't want to hide the error. I'd like to say in big letters, actually, there was an error in here, and here's a corrected version. Two little examples in a bit more detail. This is a timeline. This is a clinical study that I've done looking at a new antibiotic, which has translated into clinical practice changes in Oxford. I can't get it published. And, you know, the timeline from start to now is 3 or 4 years, and I'm still waiting. This is another example of something I'm recently working on. So this is a database looking at immune responses to hepatitis B. And my vision is to have something that's online, that's evolving over time, that researchers can search, use to generate graphics, download, and that it promotes dialogue so people can write in and say, this is how my work contributes, or can you update it? There are some challenges in this. I clearly don't have the expertise or time to make that happen. I have some anxiety about curation of a live resource that's changing over time. Journals and publishers, I think, share that concern. I find it hard to find people who want to publish something that's an idea that's evolving over time. I do need to retain ownership and be able to demonstrate citations from that. And I'm the first to say it, we're not good at going out and looking and trying to set up those conversations. How do I know who to ask? So, because I'm a scientist, I'm out of my comfort zone, really, just talking about my own opinion. So I thought I'd ask the opinion of some of my colleagues. So I sent out a little online questionnaire. This has been done in a short time frame, and it's just my sort of immediate academic circle that's represented. It was slightly too successful, so I can't share all of the data. But F1000, which is one of these new platforms for publication, has allowed me to put my slides up. They will be allocated a digital object identifier. You can see the full data set through that link. And please do, because I think it's really illuminating, actually. So I got 102 responses over 10 days, split between clinical, you know, predominantly clinical people and predominantly academic people, and a range of levels of career represented. So overall, I think the peer review process functions equitably and contributes to improving the quality of my work. Actually, not bad. You know, approaching 60% are relatively happy with that, which is fair, isn't it? Given that we complain a lot about this, I think that could have looked worse. There were some nice free text comments, which are worth looking at in more detail, but here are a few of them. More involvement by editors to weed out unhelpful comments and indeed unhelpful reviewers. Interesting. Thinking about an open review process so everyone can contribute. This is happening, but not a lot, and maybe we need to work towards that. Peer reviewing should be double-blinded, so the reviewers don't know who wrote the article, or, and I think better really, completely transparent so that we all know who we're talking to. And then from the other side of the fence, as a reviewer, lots of us put in a lot of hours, and people can feel that that's not really credited or recognised, and how can we make that process better? I'm frustrated by the length of time it takes to publish my work. Yeah, I've told you already, I've shown you a timeline. This is definitely a problem. I feel comfortable and confident contacting editors and publishers to discuss my work. There's a sort of downward drift in the wrong direction in answer to that question, I would say. And look at this, this is really interesting. This is someone who's published more than 80 papers. I've never contacted an editor or publisher to discuss a paper in advance. Should I? Do people do that? It would feel like coercion to do that. How come I didn't know to do that? Are some people getting unfair advantage by developing relationships with editors? I've clearly been missing a trick. I'll leave you with that. The process of publication is flexible, supports innovation, and allows me to be creative. We're not doing brilliantly on that, and I agree, but I do think it's coming. So I'm enthused by the opportunities that are appearing now. I've interacted with society publishers. Look, 84% of people say no. I do wonder if people have interacted with society publishers, but unwittingly, right? You don't necessarily know who's publishing your work. You kind of fire it off and hope that someone eventually prints it. And there are contrasting views on this. So someone saying they found the experience beneficial, someone saying they don't think it's high enough impact, and someone saying not really sure. And what suggestions do you have for publishers? Again, I sort of encourage you, if you're interested, to go and look at the results online. But some suggestions: more proof of concept or exploratory studies, improving the peer review process, recognition for the reviewers. The problem that research groups get very fixated on impact factor, and that's a real delaying factor in actually getting the work published. Someone just saying impact factor is broken. As well as the delay in actually getting articles accepted, there's a delay from acceptance to the article appearing in print. Can we improve that? Funding is a problem, and I think I'm lucky because I'm in an institution and have a funder who mops up the cost of publication for me, but if you're not in that situation, that can be absolutely prohibitive. Flexibility with formats, or standardising formatting between publications, and making sure that we actually have a point of contact that we can speak to in person. So I've tried to summarise what I think are the effects of this problem on us in person, and I've come up with a list of four. We all feel and look older by the time our paper finally gets into print. Everyone is cross. If I'm chasing people for their signature and they're in a conference on the other side of the world, they get pretty annoyed. Decay. The data are out of date before they get into print. And paralysis. It is very difficult, actually, to move on with the next project. And that may be because you're continually having to revise and revisit the existing piece of work, or maybe because you can't get funding because you haven't got your initial stuff into print. So I'm not going to read through this list in detail because essentially I've told you all of these things, how we want to do it. There's a lot of feedback from that questionnaire, but it's about formatting, it's about improving peer review, it's about timeliness, it's about being able to update things in real time, it's about having that conversation and not feeling that there's a taboo for us to talk to each other and that in some way that undermines the quality of the work. It's about relations with society publishing, which I think we'll hear more about later in the session, to just think about how we deal with that cost problem. And to just generally have a wider stance. How can we make this more flexible, more interesting? What are the new options that we can think about here? So I've spent 15 minutes basically complaining. I'm sorry about that. It's kind of what I was asked to do, but hopefully it's thought-provoking. And I'd just like to finish on a positive note by saying there are reasons to be optimistic. So my hepatitis B immunology database, I've had a great experience working with Oxford University IT, and I'm really optimistic that that's going to go places. We'll have to see. I did ask academics to comment on themselves and their peers in terms of their attributes, and we got collaborative, competitive, and inspiring as the top three. So that's probably a decent group of people to work with who want to make things better. There's a real willingness to discuss, and I think I was surprised by the extent to which people not only contributed to my survey, but actually gave me very generous free text comments. So I do think that people actually want to talk about this and have good ideas. And clearly that's true of you as well, otherwise I wouldn't be standing here. There are new models which I'm really enthusiastic about, and I think we should be embracing them and looking at ways to take that forward. And there's definitely a funding commitment. So the Wellcome Trust spent £31 million up to 2014 on open access. So there's a big financial boost to this process as well. So thank you for listening if you have been. And I look forward to the conversations and questions to follow. Thank you.
This just works again. Oh, magic. Thanks very much, Philippa. That was exactly what I was hoping for. And I was looking at quite a lot of previous sessions at different conferences around the world that had sort of touched on this issue before. And what I thought was interesting is that so many of them just had publishers on the stage talking about how they should engage with people. So I thought it was really, really important to have if we're going to do dialogue, then it needs to be a dialogue. So secondly, we've got Dr. Sacha Noukhovitch, who's flown over from Canada, very kindly. And Sacha is a STEM education student research expert, and he specialises in the sort of upcoming data-native generation. And he's going to talk a bit about how people are, these young people at school and university, are interacting with content now completely differently. They're engaging with the content and with the sort of structures around the content differently. And there's sort of an aspect here that the goalposts of academic engagement are also changing. So hopefully you'll enjoy this one too.
Is it possible to get another presentation?
Well, I believe it is purely to. Okay, let me get. I believe it is purely to the time difference. It is something about 4 in the morning in Toronto, so. That's what happens with presentations. They also feel this. So while we are waiting, the topic of my presentation is new faces in academic engagement. It's not me, but I saw them, these new faces. Okay. While you moved to open access, and there are other forms of electronic publications like Facebook academic journals, like e-print publications, basically what happened? There is an uninvited readership which appeared by itself, and this. Okay, I have to stay here. I decided to compensate a lack of PowerPoints with some kind of body motions. So, I don't know if you noticed that there is a lot of students tapping into your open access journals. In most cases,
We appear not to have the slides at all right now, so in a slightly drastic idea, do you think maybe we could switch to Emma, we'll load the slides up, and then we'll be able to do you in a moment? Sorry. They should be on either my emails or Sevilla's emails, but we'll find them. We'll find them. Okay. Oh, that was brilliant, wasn't it? So now we're going to move on to Emma Wilson, who is Director of Publishing at the Royal Society of Chemistry. She has over 15 years experience working in the scholarly publishing sector in a variety of different roles and different organisations. Really knows what she's talking about. And she's going to talk a little bit about the reason I looked desperately for someone who really knew what they were talking about from a society perspective was partly because of the conference, and partly because a society publisher, and particularly one with a strong publishing program like the Royal Society of Chemistry, is kind of in a prime position to talk about the way that publishing and researching and can have the community together and how they can feed off each other, and a society has so much engagement that feeds directly into the publishing program, that this should really, Emma seemed to know, have quite a lot to say that would sort of bring together what I was hoping, all the points from all the presentations, but we're going to jump to the middle. Okay. So thanks very much, Emma, and we'll sort the slides.
Great, thank you. Well, thank you, Isabel, for the introduction, and thank you very much for the invitation to be part of this discussion, and also thanks to my fellow speakers as well, and I learned a lot from Philippa's talk as well. So what I hope to do in this presentation is after a brief introduction about the Royal Society of Chemistry and our publishing programme, is to talk to you a little bit quite broadly about the sorts of face-to-face and digital engagement that we do. I'm going to talk about then about how we are seeking to coordinate that kind of community engagement we have through our publishing portfolio and integrate that with the other interactions that we have with our community through the wider work of the society. And I hope to convince you that by joining all of that up, that can have benefits for individuals, benefits for sections of our community, certainly benefits our publishing portfolio, but most importantly, how it benefits the science as well. And it really is all about advancing excellence in the chemical sciences, which is our overall overarching mission. And we are guided in doing that by our four charter objectives. And we have an objective about sharing and disseminating knowledge. Although it was interesting, the quote that we heard that said academic publishing maybe is no longer about sharing knowledge, but currently I believe that we're still in that area. We have also one about our role as a professional body and setting standards in the practice of chemistry. We act in an advisory capacity in terms of speaking to government and helping shape science policy and the science agenda. And of course, we're working with our membership as well. So this year we're celebrating 175 years and we're very proud of our global and diverse community. So this infographic hopefully just gives you a snapshot of the kind of activities that we're involved in. We're working with researchers, we're working with educators, and we're working with learners. And we're trying to have that two-way conversation. We may not always be succeeding in some parts of that, but again, it is about that two-way dialogue and not just kind of pushing out information to our community. So our publishing programme, we publish to disseminate knowledge and share information. We publish 43 peer-reviewed journals, and we're the largest publisher of, within the chemical science arena, publishing 43,000 articles last year. So we publish at scale. We have a books programme, about 1,500 print books, and also ebook collections, and we have databases, and our portfolio is sort of further enhanced by Chemistry World. And much of the work that we do around academic engagement, and I'm talking about academic engagement quite broadly, really about talking to our audience and our communities, our authors, our referees. Much of that we do via well-known and established editorial routes, which all of you will be doing as well. We do that maybe to lesser and greater extents, and there are different flavours across publishers, whether society publishers or commercial publishers. And of course, it's very interesting getting all the feedback that Philippa has just given us. I mean, there is obviously some learning to be done on some of that. A couple of the things that have really worked for us and made, I think, quite a significant difference is that we work very closely with our editorial boards, and we put a lot of effort into that engagement with our boards, and we meet sort of physically and have meetings and telephone conversations quite often. We also get out of the office a lot. We do have a lot of targeted conversations at site visits. So site visits are often done with other members of the society, for example, our careers colleagues, people, our career specialists, or also teams that are working on science and policy and with our members as well. And we go to a lot of scientific conferences as well. The other thing that we have really sort of focused on is engaging with communities internationally. And we have in-house editorial teams in India, in China, the Americas, and Japan. And that getting known and talking to that community has really been helped by integrating our own conference program with our publishing program as well. So our smaller international conferences, we really use those as a hub, and they support our publishing priorities, and that's been very successful. The other ethos that runs through, and I'll be very interested in hearing what Sacha is saying and learning from that, is about how we listen and support students and younger researchers. And I've got a few examples of that as well. So some of our journal boards have community boards, and these supplement our editorial boards, and they're made up of postgraduate and postdoctoral researchers. We also support a lot of poster prizes, and that has been very successful in engaging with and talking to students about their research and about what we can do potentially to help them share that research. Some of our quite established journals publish annually an emerging investigator special issue. And these have become quite well known in the community, and we're working with early career researchers to showcase their work in those publications. And some of the journals also supplement that with lectureship awards as well, again, to showcase the research and importantly, the scientist at an international meeting at an early stage in their careers. We do, I think one of the largest changes we've seen is around the digital interactions, and again, it's been touched on in the previous talk. And we do use social media for our journals, and we're on Twitter or on Facebook. However, much of the stuff that we do around that is really about broadcasting and pushing out content, not necessarily that two-way conversation. But one thing we have done, which I'd like to tell you about recently, which I think is a kind of conversation and helped engage and support younger researchers, was when we launched a Twitter poster conference. So the idea came in through an academic in Strathclyde on Twitter, and our journals, our analytical journals, picked that up and ran with it. We convened an organising committee. We put the hashtag out there, and we promoted the hashtag on our social media outlets. At a certain day, people that had registered for the conference took a picture of their poster, and then were available throughout that day to tweet about the science in their posters. And this is some of the kind of conversation that we had on Twitter. We ran it for the first time last year. We had 64 posters from around the world, and we ran it again this year with 80 posters, and the session increased its reach on social media as well. Chemistry World uses social media a lot, our magazine, in terms of engaging with its audience and a wider audience as well. And here is a story that I can tell you about a lobster. So we published a paper in one of our journals about the chemistry of why a lobster goes pink when it's cooked. Chemistry World wrote an article about the science in that, and that promoted a conversation on Twitter around the science as well. It also got mainstream press coverage because it was a very newsworthy story. Because it gained quite a lot of exposure on social media, it was picked up by a teacher, a chemistry teacher, who makes infographics to use in his classroom for teaching chemistry based on current research. So he did this lovely graphic, which we were then able to share with our readers on Chemistry World. Chemistry World has over 350,000 followers on Twitter, so we can put that out to a big audience as well. And eventually, the article reached a fishmonger who tweeted about the science of chemistry in cooking lobsters. And of course, that social media activity was then also represented in the altmetrics score for the journal. So again, we're able to reach kind of broad audiences in terms of some of the scientific content that we have. And then I'd like to take even a step back in terms of the kind of complexity of interacting with our community. Although we are one, we see the community that we serve, the chemists that we serve as one community, they are, of course, multiple overlapping communities. And this kind of touches on the point that Isabel said at the beginning, that at any one time, someone will have multiple touch points with us. And of course, those touch points also change throughout as a function of time. So throughout somebody's career, they'll have different interactions with us as a society, as students, and then different as young researchers, and different as more mature, when they're more established in their career. And so we were thinking about how we can leverage the networks that we have editorially and how the networks that we have within our science and our policy and our membership, and how we can make those more sort of powerful in terms of the individuals, but also for the science. And the way that we've chosen to do that is to look at areas within scientific global challenges. And I'm going to give you a case study of some work that we've done on solar fuels there. And what we've done internally around this is that we have project groups that work across the whole of the society. So we'll have the relevant journal editors, the relevant books commissioning editors, and the relevant science and policy members and the people that work with our membership in the area, in these areas. And so for solar fuels, I'm going to just give you a kind of case study of the work that we did in terms of policy, in terms of engagement with the public on this important topic, and in terms of editorial content and research content as well. And that was integrated with the conference program too. We already had the main activities started from about 2011, and we have journals and conference series based in this area already, and also a very active kind of membership division as well. Our journal, Energy and Environmental Science, is the most impactful journal that we have. And if you like impact factors, it has an impact factor of over 20. And its editor-in-chief is an American scientist who's extremely well-known in this field. So we kicked off some of this activity with a large conference in China on clean energy and worked with many Chinese scientists to formulate that conference. We developed editorial content around the topic. And then in 2011, we worked with policy makers, the EPSRC and government departments, and also talking to experts in the field to put forward quite a large science policy paper on this as well. We also worked with other sister societies, particularly the Royal Society, around some of this work too. The policy report was launched at our chemistry centre in London, and there was a public lecture on photosynthesis given by Nate Lewis, who is the editor-in-chief of our journal. And that public lecture was then broadcast by Chemistry World via a podcast, and it was also then picked up, and some of the broadcast was used by Radio 4 as well in one of their science programmes. We went on again to create and organise more conferences in this area, and also create editorial content that supported it as well. In 2013, a large international conference that we organised, and the speakers of that conference, there was also a panel discussion at the end of the meeting that was broadcast live on the World Service, again, disseminating that information to a very broad audience. More conferences, there was a photo opportunity between William Hague and the editor-in-chief of one of our journals as well, when William Hague visited Caltech. And again, in 2013, the government funded quite a significant initiative. The government funded the Solar Fuels Network, and we were able to be part of those discussions and bring our chemistry experts to that community as well. And as I said, we haven't stopped there. Again, there is more content and more conferences involved in that area, and also more media coverage in terms of radio coverage. And last month, we launched sustainable energy and fuels in this area as well, and I'm very pleased that the editor-in-chief of that publication is also the chair of the Solar Fuels Network. So kind of why, what's the impact of doing all of that kind of coordinated activity? Does it change things? Does it make a difference? Well, as a society, we are striving to be a connector and bring the right people together at the right time to discuss the right topics. So we were able to facilitate that, again, working with other societies and other government agencies to bring researchers and policymakers together. We were able to disseminate that knowledge in a very broad sense with different channels and multiple audiences, including the public, to really explain the importance of science, and in this case, particularly chemistry, in solving some of these challenges. And of course, from the publishing perspective, we were able to generate very rich streams of high-quality editorial content around this topic area. So what are the challenges of doing it like this? And there really are some challenges. So you have to talk to a lot of people a lot of the time. There are multiple internal stakeholders, different priorities, how those are aligned or not, and also talking to a lot of external stakeholders as well. How you manage and integrate internal data and information can be quite challenging. And also, this is an interesting one, there can be significant tensions in terms of focus around the UK and Europe, which much of our policy and membership work is done, versus a very international outlook that's so important for the publishing portfolio. And also, do these activities scale? Are they efficient and effective ways of having the engagement that we need? And stepping back, again, to look at the big picture, just in terms of the sort of publishing portfolio and the impact and outputs for that, we have seen some very rapid growth in the number of articles that we've published, and that has risen very significantly over the last few years. We've also been able to launch a significant number of sort of journal products to support that growth, and also our growing community, and our books output has increased by about 50% in the same time frame. So I hope I've been able to give you a snapshot. It really is a snapshot, and at quite a high not terribly granular level about how we are seeking to interact and engage with our, not just our publishing community, but our wider community as well. I've got a slide, so thank you very much. The slide says any questions, but we'll be taking those at the end. So thanks again.
Oh, Emma, you're an absolute hero. Thanks for saving the day there. But we have the slides, everything is fine. So yes, we've got Dr. Sacha Noukhovitch is going to talk about the way that the goalposts of academic engagement are changing the new generation. Thanks.
Actually, I'm quite grateful that I'm doing the last presentation. The previous one, thank you, made my life easy. Dissemination of knowledge. It's exactly what made the situation different. There is a new crowd tapping into this disseminated knowledge. Electronic publications, open access publications, Twitter, presence of scientific facts and even Facebook scholarly journals. Actually invited students, I mean undergraduate students and high school students, totally different generation, totally different crowd of readership to tap directly into scholarly publication. It is clearly understandable that this readership doesn't have academic background, doesn't have knowledge. But what is interesting, it is their ability. This is a new data native generation, and they are different compared to you. They are different in the way they're handling the information. In most cases, at least judging by my experience, I understand that when I'm analyzing facts, I probably follow the pattern I was taught in school. I follow the scientific method I was taught in university. This is a natural data scientist. Students who came with experience, let's say 16, 17-year-old student would have 14 years of data analysis experience from the age of 2 or 3, sorting through the enormous amounts of data, figuring out how to process this data, how to find patterns, how to sort out actually significant amount of information on their own. It presents totally different situation in school because these students come to school with their own learning style. They are not traditional type of learners. And this is how they are coming to scholarly publications. They are coming to scholarly publications already prepared, at least for from their own perspective. And interesting enough, their approach produces interesting results. Interesting results regardless of the fact that they don't have formal or, let's say, classical academic upbringing. We've been running for 3 years so-called Big Data Challenge for high school students. We've been giving high school students real data sets, huge amounts of data, putting absolutely enormous problems, and providing them with professional tools, like statistical analysis system toolset, like Dell Statistica, or IBM Big Data University toolset, workbench. And with no prior training, students within a period of 3 months were able to crunch and mine this data, producing absolutely breakthrough results of value. Last year, Big Data Challenge was done on the Open Data Toronto, where they analyzed facts, where they analyzed data sets from plumbing to health to transportation to everything. And one of the projects actually defined which area of Toronto is best for the settlement of immigrants. Complex factor, which generated absolutely huge discussion among experts. Another project which was defined the wealth and tendency of health and wealth correlations, also how actually three factors, education, health and wealth, how they are correlated and where investment can bring you the most result. This year, we actually have I would say we have a super goal. We're providing students with access to Allmetric data. Thanks for Allmetric and digital science. And students will have a simple task to find the future of science. I also want to say that when you mentioned challenges, that's what students love. They don't understand any, they don't have the knowledge of problems. They don't see the complexity of the issues you present to them. And that's why they have a freedom of attacking and getting into these problems with enthusiasm and ability of these type of different type of learners. So disseminated knowledge, which created by you, met by a new crowd of students, brings in very interesting very interesting situation, or very interesting, puts into very interesting position. Modern students read research papers and use online academic communities to understand and interpret complex concepts. They are crowdsourcing. They are, well, I don't know if it is right comparison. If anybody barbecued in the fall, you probably noticed how wasps, if one finds your meat, there will be a team in 5 minutes attacking your meat. That's exactly how what happens with students. If one stumbled on an interesting fact, there will be five digging into it, and then they will take all of what they tapped into, and they are not really reading the paper. They're picking and choosing. They're biting into your papers. And then they're bringing it to online community, where actually there are real scientists enjoying this type of audience. And they're generating knowledge. They're generating knowledge. Have a look. This is a new type of, I can't say, this is a publication. Papers we love. But actually, it is more than publication, because each, it's not a paper, each topic is authored by multiple authors at the same time and learned from it by whole crowd of those who are participating in it. Currently, it is, let's say, around the topics of computer science, which is the first thing where they feel themselves comfortable. But it is not the end. Cura, it is another field where students congregate, where they form, and this is what I want to highlight. Students and professional scientists, and basically whoever has a knowledge, form communities. They have no any association, but interest in the topic. They have no legal binds, and they still work together as an institution, trying to, as a project, to reach to certain results. The driving force behind all these new forms, these reading groups, let's say Papers Will Laugh, it is known as a reading group. And QR, again, this is a new generation of data native students. So, data native students is the dominant crowd in these online research and learning communities. I want to highlight the fact that this is learning communities, because this is a different kind of education also. It is not only scholarly publishers, it is also universities who are who have to reckon with these new ways of learning. And here is the example of Reddit, where I believe a lot of you are familiar with this scientific journal, where you can pick up any field of science, and there are established scientists, although there are also whoever, and there is plenty of unfiltered presentation. What I want to say here, and kind of give you as an idea, I believe from the scientific point of view, Internet became a renaissance type of environment, which is generating a renaissance type of scientist. And this is this new generation of students. They are not subject specific, simply due to their upbringing, simply due to their way of interaction. There is no borders between sciences in internet, and that's what makes whole difference. Taking this opportunity, I want to brag a bit, saying that we kind of put these talents to use. it was natural simply to make use of these potentials. So STEM Fellowship and STEM Fellowship Journal, kindly sponsored and published by Canadian Science Publishing. It is the first opportunity for undergraduate and high school students to get published in a scholarly way, to get peer-reviewed and get involved in editorial work for real. This is our organization is student-driven, and it has grown on its own, and currently takes place in 9 universities. To give an example, University of British Columbia, University of Calgary, McGill, Western Ontario, McMaster, Waterloo, Toronto. There is 40 high school ambassadors, 45 student executives, and so on and so on. We implement two-level review process. There is a student editorial board, which does basically most of the work. And then there is an open PhD process. And here is here are the faces. I promised you I saw them. There is a specialization in student review. Yes, they have their field of expertise. Although they are cross-disciplinary, they do have a field of expertise, but their review approach is quite different from expert. They do their own investigation. They don't verify, let's say, wealth of their knowledge against what they read. They don't judge. That's the point. They actually resort to online community to and that's how they are doing their first evaluation of the paper. And then, like Nikki, she's in charge of data review process, data scientist from, well, not data scientist, she's a student at University of Toronto. She's actually prefers to do her own data analysis along with any paper she's reviewing. So that's the level of enthusiasm you can get from this generation. I want to kind of introduce Mohamed Asadilari, Managing Director for Scholarly Writing and Publication, a student from University of British Columbia. I don't know, you have very strong international connections. I don't know if you noticed that there is a different approach in different academic approach, at least if you would compare, let's say, Iranian physics school or Toronto physics school. And it is actually quite common. There is a divide between Western and Eastern analysis and academic approach. Although, yes, everybody worked for the same. In your translation, when working with Chinese authors, I believe it's more than translation which is necessary there. There is actually a bit different approach. This type of editor got both, and this is the nature of these new students. If I would dare to spend a bit more time venturing into the topic of anime, that is beautiful example how Chinese culture, actually kabuki theater, was popularized through the whole world and implemented into the brains of the next generation. It's not an it's not a cartoon. It is actually theater, classical Japanese theater. That's what it is. So, putting this, going back to having got this type of students, they are cross-cultural. They are cross-cultural and actually they are polyglot. We have an editor who is Bulgarian, but there is no better English editor, simply because I believe, I know that her regions are Bulgarian, but her language abilities from the capital letter, are absolutely superb. And that is another powerful thing, Vasi Sharlandjieva. Well, it's easier to call her by her first name. So, because this is kind of, it's a new generation of readership, a new something which will come to you maybe in 5 years, maybe earlier. Actually, they are already reading your journals, especially those which they can access to. And in this regard, I would like to point to what opportunities this new crowd gives you. I don't know, consciously or unconsciously. Yes, but academic publishers are now in position that allows them to participate in new forms of education, these communities. They're already feeding these communities. And new scholarly publication forms, they're already there. New editorial requirements have to be implemented to better fit get your product integrate into this crowd better. And publishers can now directly cultivate future readership and even can form popular opinion. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Sacha. I think what's particularly interesting there is that it's all very well to listen, but you've also sometimes got to seek out knowledge as well, because it might be coming in from the side, from channels you weren't even listening to. So we sort of, for various reasons, only have a couple of minutes, but we do have a couple of minutes. So if there are any questions, we can probably take one or two quite quickly, and then maybe we can talk about it outside, because there's plenty to go on. Do we have a microphone? One at the front.
I'm David Thomas with Thomson Reuters. The question, the last presentation you said about the way that the new generation is learning.
Yeah.
It's quite different, I should say just different from the generation or previous generations. What does that mean for scholarly publishing from the standpoint of the access to journals, the distribution of journals to the wider public outside the standard academic community?
Well, scholarly publishers is in the business of presenting and disseminating of knowledge. And it is not far away from teaching. When a new reader doesn't really read in a sequential way, when they are jumping from the beginning to the middle, then they go back. So they expect, they're getting really bored with the traditional way of presentation of information. They want to, if I would have an answer for you, I wouldn't be probably sitting here. this is what I am doing. That's why we are running STEM Fellowship. We're actually learning from students. We're learning how they are looking up the answer, and this is not really an answer. This is a way how they are covering material. They will be looking up the answer after answer, which is not answers. And then they would try to put the puzzle together. So expectation of, laying out everything the way author did it. It is one way of presenting. It is another and maybe more efficient way of sharing the findings, is actually presenting these findings as jewels on the on a piece of nice velvet,
velvet,
yes, saying here they are, which one do you need for your or whoever is doing research, they're like a jewelers, they are putting them together for we don't have an answer. The process is so interesting to learn how they learn.
It's kind of the biggest possible question, isn't it? What does this mean for scholarly publishing? We sort of run out of time. I don't know if Emma or Philippa have a couple of comments on what they think it might mean for scholarly publishing. If anyone else has any other questions, I'd encourage people to come up and talk to us about it at the end.
To agree, because I think there are going to be, in my view, multiple kind of changes in the way that people share and disseminate information and the way they learn from that. And I think one of the kind of priorities for us will be to have a much deeper understanding of what the younger researchers want and need, and how they use information. And that is really going to be key to how we sort of do our future planning in terms of strategies. And I don't think that we know enough about that, or I don't certainly.
So thanks very much for coming along. I hope we'll all go out and really think a bit more carefully about how we can seek out as many voices as possible and feed as many of them in to what we do next. I've come up with quite a few ideas of things I'm going to take back, and I hope you have too. So yeah, enjoy coffee and come and have a chat to us if you want to at the end. And sorry for the problems in the middle, but thanks very much.